This is the day the Lord's made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Amen. Thank you, Father. You know, one of the things I love about the Lord is that He always invites us into new and glorious encounters. And so people are encounters at the moment. There's a presbytery going on, so that's awesome. Bless them, Lord. But I want us this morning to posture our hearts in a way that if the Lord says, "Behold, I do a new thing," then we can't come with old thinking. If He says, "Behold, I do a new thing," then we can't say, "But Lord, what about that?" We have to fix our eyes. One of the things I love about Revelation, in Revelation chapter 3, it says that Jesus is standing at the door knocking. He said, "If any man opens the door," He said, "I'll come in and dine with him and he with me." That's about Him stepping into our space. But then in Revelation 4, it says, "Behold, I saw an open door. And the voice said, come up here and I will show you things that must take place after this." That's us stepping into Him. And so in Revelation 3, He's stepping into us. In Revelation 4, we're stepping into Him. And so I'm praying today for a Revelation 4 encounter that get to step into. Also as well, we encounter Him stepping into us. Amen? That we encounter this bilateral, we encounter this paradox of God stepping into us and us stepping into Him. And so, Father, we just say today, as we come and worship You today, as Lord, as the atmosphere of praise, as the atmosphere of worship arises in this place, Lord, I'm asking You for heavenly encounters. Lord, that we would have the Son of God step in. And we, as sons of God, would step in also. Holy Spirit, we're inviting You to do what You do best. Wow. Why don't you pray this prayer with me this morning? Say, "Father, I want to step into You. And I want You to step into me." That's called communion. Wow. So, Lord, we thank You for heavenly communion today. Father, we thank You that we get to commune with You on such a level, Lord, that goes beyond human reason, that goes beyond any emotion, Father. We want to step into ecstasies today. Lord, we want to step into trances today. Lord, we want to step into them places, Lord, that go beyond, Lord, our mind, that go beyond, Lord, our hearts. Father, that we want to step, as John said, as Paul said, "I don't know whether I was in my body or out of the body, but I was with the Lord." And so, Lord, we're asking You for them, Lord, them ecstasies today, Lord, them transformational encounters. Lord God, them, Father, places of going up in the Spirit. Father, we want to come up in the Spirit today. Lord, we want heavenly vantage points today in this place. Lord, we refuse to be earthly bound. Lord, we want to be heavenly abounding in Jesus' name. Wow. So I want us right now, if we can, just to put our hands out and say, "Father, I receive everything that You have for me. I receive according to John 1 that I am a receiver. I am a receiver of heavenly things in Jesus' name." And so, Lord, with that prayer today, we come and worship. We come and praise. And, Lord, we come and step into heavenly realities today in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Let's bless the worship team today. Father, bless them as they lead us in Jesus' name.
Hey. And the sun's coming up. It's a brand new morning. And the sun's coming up. It's a brand new day. And the sun's coming up. It's a brand new morning. And the sun's coming up. It's a brand new day. Sing that with me. 'Cause the sun's coming up, it's a brand new morning. When the sun's coming up, it's a brand new day. When the sun's coming up, it's a brand new morning. When the sun's coming up, it's a brand new
hear my guitar out there? You can. It's just me up here, can't you? Do you know what? I heard Gary say last week, if it was about... if it was just about content, it would be enough. It has to be about intent. Do you know, I'm singing this here this morning. I woke up yesterday morning. I can't hear my guitar stand. But I woke up yesterday and I felt like it was, the sun was coming up and I've looked and I'm journaling and I'm going, God, we need you. Does anybody else need him? You know, not just for the fun of it. You know, not just to do church. You know, the sun's coming up, it's a brand new morning. And I just start singing. Yeah, the sun's coming up, it's a brand new morning. It's for nothing. Yeah, the sun's coming up, it's a brand new day. Choice like you do every day. The sun's coming up, it's a brand new morning. we're going to declare it in any case, you know.
Nothing can hold us back. We don't be afraid, cause you made a way for me.
Take two.
Nothing can hold us back. We don't be afraid, cause you made a way for me.
Thank you.
Thank you.
up. I had a dream last night. I saw these balloons, and they were full. They were pregnant. The balloons were pregnant, and he just wanted us to pull them down over ourselves. He just wanted to pull them down over ourselves, break them over ourselves. What are the dreams that you hold that you have not yet even stepped into? What are the dreams that you have for yourself, for your family, that you haven't even stepped into yet? Look, 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 the balloons are there. Just grab them up, pull them down. Pull them down, get drenched by what's inside them. Father, we just thank you that your freedom is in this place today. We don't come for a bunch of meetings, guys. We come to encounter the King of Kings. Thank you.
such an atmosphere of praise here today. I just don't want us to miss this moment because, listen, we talk about praise being opening gates. You know, there was a move that every single person in this room benefited from, and it's called the Latter Rain move. And it was a move that reestablished a few things in the spirit. But can I tell you, it started from 3 months of them teaching on praise and on opening your mouth and giving a sacrifice of praise. And on 3 months mark, bang, Holy Spirit comes and shifts the body of Christ. You think your praise is just small or whatever, but sometimes we just need to stand up and give a sacrifice of praise. I'm going to ask the congregation with me to stand up right now. You can sing in your own tongue, you can release, but I just feel like we've got to praise here because we've been shown that praise opens gates. And I feel like the Lord wants to open something in this meeting. Father, we want to open something in this meeting. I want to ascend unto the hill of the Lord. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. Who shall go up the hill of the Lord? He who has clean hands and a pure heart, who does not lift up his soul to an idol, nor swear by what is false. Open the gates. Come on, just begin to open the gates. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. Salvation belongs to our God who sits upon the throne. He's the King of Kings. He's the Lord of Lords. Every name shall submit to him. Every name, every name, every name, every name is under his feet. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. Salvation. Worthy is the Lamb. 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 Come on, we're not going to be led by music right now. Come on, come on, come on. Release the sacrifice of praise. You're the people of praise. We decree that name on you. You're the people of praise. We declare your glory, Lord. Come on, we declare your glory. We declare your glory. Come on, lift your hands, begin to ask. Come on. Someone's shoulder issue on the right-hand side. Who is that? Someone with a shoulder issue on the right-hand side. Some pain around here, around the shoulder on the right-hand side. Who is that? Chris, come. Is that you, Chris? Come. Come on, no. Don't come out of the spirit. The Lord wants to do more in this meeting. Just begin to continue to receive. Continue to receive. Dave, come down. Natalia, why don't you come pray? Thank you, Lord. Shh. like the Lord's putting heat on some parts of the body. Like I feel like there's heat on someone's neck or something like that. Be healed in Jesus' name. Just begin to move it. We don't need to have laid hands on for people to get healed right now because the Holy Spirit's here. I'm not going to call out words of knowledge anymore. If you want to, if you feel that you want to come up the front and get prayed for from healing, quickly come up quickly right now. Okay, come on, petition him, Lord. Come on, petition the Holy Spirit. We want more, Father. We want more of you. Lord, why don't you just ask the Lord, encounter me today, Lord. Why don't you just ask the Lord, encounter me today, Lord. Encounter me today, Lord. Because He wants to encounter you more than you want to encounter Him.
When I was asked to do communion last week, I just asked God what He wanted to say and what He wanted me to share. And the verse that came straight to mind was that there is no greater love than this, to lay one's life down for his friends. And I was pondering that over the week and just trying to get more from what God wanted to say. But this morning, as I came in to church, my Bible has on my phone has a pop-up that is the verse of the day, and it was that exact verse: "There is no greater love than to lay one's life down for his friends." And Jesus has saw each one of your lives before the creation of the world. He saw you, and he came at a time in creation to lay his life down for each one of us. And his heart for us is just so amazingly profound. You know, I've heard it said so many times that, you know, if you were the only person on the earth, that Jesus would have died for you. And there's something about that, like there's a element of the, you know, there's a truth to that, but there's something about that I go, you know, that isn't the reality, because there's more than just me. And even though he sees me, when he sees me and he sees you, he looks at you with eyes of love that are just so wholly focused upon each one of us. And it's as though we're the only person, you know, that existed. And so there's that truth, but at the same time, you know, right at the beginning, God said that it wasn't good for man to be alone. You know, so it's like we need each other. And God's love for us goes beyond our individual selves, even though that is so profound. And it's through that relationship that when we come together and recognize the Creator, the one who laid his life down for each one of us, and do that corporately, that there's a joy unspeakable that goes beyond just ourselves. And so we're going to take communion together as a family. So if you want to come up and take the bread and the juice, come up and we'll take it together. Over the last couple of days, there's been a window of opportunity that's been opening up, and there's a great call on each of our lives to come deeper into the Lord. And over the last couple of days in particular, there's been windows opening up in the heavenlies, and for whatever reason, like, God has chosen this time for us to come closer to Him, and we're going from glory to glory. And so today there's a great call on our lives to step in deeper, to realize His love for us and for each other, and ultimately to step deeper into Him. You know, God's rule is love. He doesn't command us, He doesn't bark orders to us. His command is His rule is love. Father, we recognize that You sent Your Son Jesus to lay down His life for us, to do the impossible, to do what we couldn't do for ourselves, to be brought back into communion with You and with each other. Lord, we recognize you are the only way, you are the only one, and it was only by your blood, Lord. It was only by your broken body, by your blood, that we could be saved. So, Lord, we serve you wholeheartedly, but you no longer call us servants, you call us friends. Lord, and you love us with a deep, everlasting, abiding love. And there's no more greater call than to live in you, to love in you, to be found in you, to have every part of our being found in you. So, Lord, we serve you with everything. But we thank you that you're a lover. So, Lord, we just lay down everything at your feet. We lay it all down. We give you our everything, Lord. We recognize this opportunity, Lord, to come deeper, because you are our everything, Lord. You are our everything. And Lord, we recognize that your body was broken for us so we could enter in, we could freely enter in. So let's take the bread together. Thank you for your blood, Lord, that washes away our every sin, every stain, every blemish. We are made pure, we are made clean, we are made white as snow, Lord. No one else can do this, Lord, but you. And you've done it. And so, Lord, we do this, Lord, in remembrance of you, knowing that you're coming back for us, Lord. And we just take the blood. This world can be cruel sometimes. It was cruel to you, Lord. It was cruel to you. We were cruel to you, Lord, at one time. But, Lord, you persevered for the joy set before you. Lord, you saw us in your eyes, Lord, in your eyes of eternity. I just want you to take just one moment now, just close your eyes and just imagine Jesus after being beaten and walking down the dusty road to be crucified and the torment that he was put under. And just to look around, he looks around and he looks at you straight in the eye, and he sees you. And he keeps going. He keeps going for you. Thank you.
beautiful name. Such a beautiful name. The 24 elders the four living creatures, the cherubim and the seraphim all cry, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Lord, you're so good. You are so worthy. You are so worthy. Lord, every fiber of our being gives you praise. Lord, I am not moved by what I see or hear or feel. I am moved by the Spirit of God. And anything else is an idol. We bow the knee. God, we bow the knee. King of kings and Lord of lords. Lord, we bow our hearts today to you. Royalty is in this place. Royalty is in this place. The procession of kingship is in this place. Heirs of salvation are in this place. Lord, we bow the knee.
From you.
friend, I want to invite you right now to lay an altar of worship again in your heart. You may be in a season where you felt the altars of your worship are in ruin. I want to tell you right now, you are a living stone. You haven't come to a mountain made by hands. You've come to the mountain of God, Zion. You are the communion place of God. You are the living stones that He has placed together as an altar of worship, built up into a dwelling place for God. Thank you, Lord. So, Lord, right now we lay aside the ruin and we lay hold of the renewing. We lay aside the ruin and we lay hold of the renewing of our hearts, renewing of our minds, renewing of them places of worship, renewing of them places of prayer, renewing of them places of intimacy, renewing of them places of worship and praise, of thanksgiving, of offering. Not laying again the foundations of our faith, but building upon them. Lord, we press in, we press on, and we press through. In Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Let's give Him praise in this place. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Wow. Woo. Why don't you love on someone? Just love on them and greet each other with a holy kiss or a miss. Jesus. Bless the Lord. Wow. Thank you, Lord. All good. Yay, God. Well, bless you, each and every one of you. It's so good to see you. Welcome to Hillview Community Church. My name's Gary Morgan. It's so good to have you here. Wow. How many people are still feeling the depth of what just happened? Well, we're so excited today. We have a special guest with us, or should I say guests? We have Mike and Charmaine Elteringham with us from Dubai. So good to have them. We're going to be listening to them in a moment, but it's so good to have them here. I wonder if there's any birthdays or anniversaries. If you can grab the basket of blessing, or should we say for some it'll be any birthdays or anniversaries? We got little Tobias is coming up in on September, so I'm going to take, Sunday, it's coming up Sunday. Anyone else? Steve, you got yours coming up? Or are you going to grab it next Sunday? No other birthdays or anniversaries? Anyone want to make up this their birthday or anniversary? Oh, that already is. Awesome. Well, bless you guys. Awesome. Well, we're going to take up our tithes and offerings, but before we do, there's some notices. Atlas is going to be coming up on this Monday. Axe Swimming is coming up next month. Also, as well, seniors is coming up next month. If you want to see seniors, give us a wave, Peter and Aileen. Also as well in July, just to let you guys know, is Jamie, I'm going to prophesy. Let's have Jeremy and Jamie. Jamie Galloway is going to be with us. We did have a video, but the audio's not working. Jamie Galloway is going to be with us in July. Now, this is a ticketed event, but there's early bird registration. It goes until, I believe, the 9th of June, and you can get early bird tickets. And so this place is probably going to pack out. There's already, we're up in tickets. And so I want to encourage you, jump on hillview.org.au/Jamie Galloway, and you can register there. Jamie moves in a pretty unique prophetic gifting, particularly in the healing and signs and wonders. I personally believe he's walking in what John Paul Jackson walked in that area. And so I'm excited. Jamie at the moment is in San Diego with Jeremy Miranda Nelson. And so I'm excited to see what he brings. Amen? God's good? Awesome. Well, if you got your tithes and offerings, we're gonna make a declaration. If we can have that declaration up, you know, one of the things I realized is God loves a cheerful giver, but I realize God is a cheerful giver Himself. Amen. And Jesus is a cheerful giver. Why? It says, "For the joy set before Him, He gave Himself to the cross," and so He doesn't require of us anything that He is not. And so we don't worship a dictator who's asking us to do things that He hasn't done. John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that He gave His best." Yeah? And so everything God invites us to, He's already done Himself. And this is what I love about God. This is what I love or loved as an atheist coming in to Christianity, is every other religion for me was all about this awesome deity or God, and everyone had to try and attain it. But amazingly for me, Jesus became the lowest so I could be lifted up. He gave everything so that I could have everything. And that's what I could not argue when it came to believers knocking on my door. I could argue with every other religion, but when it came to Jesus, that it wasn't founded on the awesomeness and the victory of you know, the God. It was based on the place of He chose to die so I could live. Amen? And so I want to invite us right now. If we can all stand, we're going to make a declaration. If you are watching online and you want to join us in this offering, you can do so through PushPay, or if you're here, you can do that as well. But we want to make this declaration, and if you give virtually, then you can join with us in this as well. And so let's declare this. As we receive today's offering, we are believing You for heaven opened, earth invaded, storehouses unlocked, and miracles created. Dreams and visions, angelic visitation, signs and wonders. Sorry. Anointing, gifting, and calls. Positions and promotions. Provisions and resources to go to the nations. Souls and more souls from every generation, saved and set free, carrying kingdom revelation. Thank You, Father, that as I join my value system to Yours, You will pour out favor, blessing, and increase upon me, so I have more than enough to co-labor with heaven and see Jesus get His full reward. Hallelujah and amen. Let's receive today. We're going to pass the buckets around. In Jesus' name, amen. Bless the Lord. Wow. There's some funky music playing somewhere. God is so good. Amen. Prophetic message right there. So good. Well, before we invite Mike and Charmaine to come, Steve's going to give us a quick update on the mission to Sri Lanka coming up in a few weeks. Amen. So let's welcome Steve.
So just really quickly, just wanted to thank you and encourage you to keep praying. You know, we're believing for
a really incredible healing move. So we're there on the I think it's about the 28th. So there's a bunch of people coming with us, but basically when we first get there, we're going straight to the hill country, and a lot of these places don't even have electricity where we are. So not necessarily in Hatton itself, but I think we do a kids thing first. Is that right? Yeah. So we do a kids conference first, right? But then we're going to be doing like a pastors conference. So we're going to be looking after going after the pastors and leaders, and then we're actually going after we're going to be doing healing and miracle nights. How many want to hear some stories? You know, last time we were in Alice Springs, Andrea and I, we literally saw an eye grow back. So I'm actually looking forward to seeing every kind of miracle take place amongst these people. These guys have actually brought, I think, who was here when Tim spoke? He said he'd I've been doing it for about 5 years, brought approximately 14,000 people to the Lord, 14,000 kids to the Lord. How many think that's amazing? So can I ask you to pray? One of the congregation, I want to honor them. I think they're in this room today, spontaneously gave, and I just want to thank them for that. It goes straight to the costs associated with doing that. So we're doing miracle meetings. Then we're actually going to trek in the nights into the villages, you know, through swamps, into villages. I don't know if it's swamps. It's, yeah. Maris is all up. Maris and I and Warren, we're all up, right? I can't wait, because we go to villages that have no light. So we literally have to take light. And apparently they come to you and just ask for prayer, the Hindus. And as it happens, people just come to the Lord, yeah? So can I ask you to pray? Can I ask you to pray with us and join and partner with us? That would be awesome. Gary, I'll hand back to you.
Awesome. Isn't that amazing? Take some LEDs. It's all good. LEDs are amazing. Can light up anything with LEDs. Awesome. Well, guys, it's our absolute honor today to welcome to this house a couple that need no introduction, but we're going to give one. And the legacy and the heritage and the substance that is on this couple is just phenomenal. And I just love being around these guys, because I feel like I'm back in the Acts of the Apostles, because you just hear some amazing stories about what God is doing in the nations, expanding and just taking, you know, the gospel and taking territory for the Lord. And so we have an honor today to receive the word from Mike Eltringham. So, Mike, we want to invite you. Let's welcome Mike as he comes and shares the word with us today. Let's honor this general of the faith in Jesus' name.
Awesome, man. Let me pray for you.
Father, we just thank you. Stretch your hands out. Father, we thank you for Mike right now. Lord, we give him, Lord, the keys to this house. Lord, we say, Lord, let the wells open up. And Father, let him minister with freedom. Father God, in the spirit. And Lord God, with signs and wonders following. In Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Amen.
Keep talking very loudly until it comes on. Great to be back. It's wonderful to be with Gary and Sarah again. Thank you for sending them to us fairly regularly. They're a great blessing, and you receive the reward of sending them all the way to Dubai and wherever else we've had Gary. But great to be back in Australia for our, I don't guess it's about 20th visit. Second visit, third visit here, I think it is. And very excited about what God is doing around the world. I was 2 weeks ago in Cambodia, my first trip, and working with a wonderful young man. He's real heart for church planting, which is absolutely my heart. I do believe that the Great Commission that we're all on. Great to hear about Sri Lanka. I'm there. I've been there 20 or 30 times. We work with an amazing apostolic man there. We've got churches all over the nation. But I believe the most effective way of fulfilling the Great Commission is through church planting. Because our mandate is to make disciples, not converts. And the only way to really make disciples is to have them in community, where they are loved, love's coming through this morning, where they are loved and they are at times disciplined and trained, and iron sharpens iron, the Bible says, that's God's way. God puts you with people you don't really like to be with all the time. That's God's way. Amen? We can't choose our family. And so we're excited to be there, first time in Phnom Penh, working with a guy. He's planted churches in 17 of the 25 provinces of Cambodia. And he knows very little about church planting. He's a first-generation Christian himself. And all of his leaders, all of his church leaders are first-generation Christians out of Buddhism. All got a story about brokenness, lost lives through the Khmer Rouge, the 3+ million people who were slaughtered back in the 70s, late 70s. And a couple of weeks before that, or a month or two before that, I was in a place called Kosovo, Kalamos. We had people from Kosovo there. That's in Athens, in Greece. And we had people from Albania and Kosovo and Morocco and Iraq and Iran and Macedonia. And most of them come also first-generation Christians out of either Islam or out of communism. And church planting, loving Jesus, worshiping God. And I came back from these two trips with one word. And it was, God is unstoppable. The gospel and the kingdom is unstoppable. It doesn't matter what the enemy has tried to do for thousands of years, the church of Jesus Christ, Jesus said, I'm going to build my church, and the gates of hell will not be able to stop the advancing church. But we need to be advancing. And so I want to say that we're really excited. Great to be here in Australia. It's an amazing nation. I'm often in third world nations. It's great to be in a first world nation where pretty much everything does work, including lights and electricity. But I want to say that God has got a heart for this nation. And there's a whole bunch of stuff that he still wants to do in this nation. Amen? You've got some work to do. God's got some work to do in this nation. And so I want to speak a word I feel like God's led in my heart for this morning. And the title of it, if you do take notes, and for those who are doing the electronic stuff, I've called this Negative to Positive. And it's a message that kind of stirred in my heart a little while back. And God kind of reminded me that he specializes in turning negative situations into positive ones. God can do anything. God is the God of the impossible. But he specializes in turning negative situations into positive ones. And I thought about this, that the cross in itself is a negative thing, the cross, but it's this divine plus that stood on Golgotha, on Calvary, for all time, center of all of the scripture we have, center of all that God ever did from Adam through to his return. Salvation and the cross was always God's first plan. And it stands as this forever plus on the planet. And whenever the devil comes with his negatives and his minuses, God has placed this divine positive, this divine plus. And I feel like God wants to do that in some lives here today and in the nation of Australia. What the enemy is doing, all of his negatives that he brings, God, and even today, is going to bring about this divine positive. I want to read the scripture that's really based out of this message from Colossians chapter 2 and verse 13. It says this, Paul writing, and he says, Holy Spirit through Paul, and he says this, and you who are dead... How many believe dead is a negative thing? All right? Well, the three of us were absolutely convinced. Death is not a good thing. You are dead, the Bible says. The Holy Spirit says, you and I were dead.
in our trespasses and in the uncircumcision of our flesh, but God made us alive. We had the sentence against us, all of humanity were dead. Even while we were breathing, we were dead in our trespasses and sin. But God came with his divine plus, the cross, Jesus. He made us alive together with him, having forgiven us our trespasses, and he canceled. That's what he did. He canceled the record of debt that stood against us with all its legal demands. This he set aside by nailing it to the cross. What an incredible thing, folks. And we need to sing more about the cross. And I know it's not the end. The cross was, in a way, the beginning. There's the death, but of course there is the resurrection. But the cross, and we celebrated today, the breaking of bread, the blood of Jesus. There is such incredible power. This feast, this event that we remember today and every day, should be, is such an incredible reminder to us that God is a God who transforms negative things into positive things. Isaiah 43 and verse 2. When you pass through the waters, God says, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they will not overwhelm you. And when you walk through fire, you shall not be burned. And the flames shall not consume you. A couple of thoughts by way of introduction. Then I want to share a few situations, which I hope some of them are applicable to you. First of all, we have this in Scripture, the principle of first the natural and then the supernatural. And Paul picks us up in his letter to the Romans, and he says, the world is without excuse. His invisible attributes, Romans 1:20, namely his eternal power, his divine nature, have been clearly perceived ever since the creation of the world in things that have been made. So they are without excuse. God delights in taking the very simple things, or profound things in a way, but very natural things to explain supernatural events. And as I was preparing this word, I was reminded, changing, are we okay? Can you hear me? Yeah. All right. While they twiddle. God, as he was speaking to me about turning negatives into positive, divine positives, I was reminded about lightning. And I don't know about you, but I was not a great scholar at school. And so I had to Google. Thank the Lord for Google. So I had to Google about lightning. And as I did, I was just amazed how it's this great demonstration. We had a bit of thunder last night too. So God was just confirming to me. Did you hear the thunder? And I love lightning and thunder. But for those who don't know, like me, Google. Lightning is an electrical current caused by the clashing together of bits and pieces of ice in the cloud. And as they clash together, as they collide together, they form an electrical negative and positive charges, protons and electrons. And a separation happens in the clouds. The positives move to the top and the negatives move to the bottom of the cloud. And because opposites, one of the laws we have in God, God set it up in the universe, the laws of opposites attract. These negative currents that are now sitting in the bottom of the thunderstorm clouds cause a forming of the positives on the earth. And normally they gravitate to the highest place, either a high hill or building or a tree or even people. And suddenly they're as the currents flow, negative to positive. And this is exactly what God does. And when the lightning bolt comes out of the heavens, it flashes at a
54,000 degrees Fahrenheit. That's hot. That's 6 times hotter than the sun. There's this explosive power from the heavens that comes as opposites are attracted, as the negative is attracted to the positive, the positive to the negative. And I believe it's just this incredible natural picture of what God does and wants to do all the time. There's this overwhelming power of God that comes and cancels the negative of the enemy, if we allow him to, again and again and again. And I was reminded of the story in Luke 10, when the disciples came back to Jesus. They'd been sent out, commissioned, and had gone out, and they came and they said, with great joy, it said, "Lord, even demons are subject to us in your name." And Jesus said, "I saw Satan fall like bang." Why? Because the positive and the negatives, the positives are attracted to the negative. And so while the disciples were doing, casting out demons, Jesus said, "I saw a dethroning, I saw a changing in the ruling principalities and powers in that region." That's why, folks, we have to be casting out demons. We can debate till the cows come home with people, and we can argue. But these disciples started moving in authority and started operating in the kingdom, and this divine positive came in a very negative situation. People who were demonized suddenly had the power and the glory of God come. Effectively, the kingdom. And so Jesus says in Luke 11, "If by the finger of God I cast out demons, know that the kingdom of God has come." So wherever we preach, let us preach with power in Sri Lanka. We want to see the kingdom of God cancel out these negative powers of darkness, false religion, bondage in all forms and all sorts. So, couple of principles and a couple of pictures from Scripture. Number one, God is a God of transformation. Not only information. He wants information to come by way of revelation. But I want to say, folks, revelation without transformation is useless. We have people with incredible knowledge, incredible wisdom, and some with revelation. But unless they are doing something with what they had impacted in their life, it's not, and which results in transformation, it's useless. We don't want armchair anointings in the church. More, Lord, give us more, 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 more. And there we are becoming more and more and more bloated with revelation. I said this when I was in Cambodia, which wasn't politically correct. And I was talking about how people get so full and full and full and full of knowledge, they start looking like Buddha. And I just thought, this is probably not a good illustration here. But that's exactly what happens with Christians. More conferences, more guest speakers, more different translations of the Bible, more podcasts, more this, and there's nothing wrong with any of those things. But folks, if the power and the glory of God that we say and sing about is real in our hearts, what are we doing with it? We have to take what we receive. These churches for me are like field hospitals in a war. We come in a little bit banged up and beaten up, very beaten up, dead actually, the Bible says, until we get saved. You are dead. We have living corpses coming in and they get transformed by the power of God. And then get trained and equipped and filled with the Holy Spirit and with all kinds of training and release and encounters with God. But the purpose is so that we go out and transform the nations. Amen? How are you doing? We're going to measure everyone's spiritual waste at the end of this meeting. Because God wants to empower us, but not to sit in our lazy, spiritual lazy boys.
God is a God of transformation. Isaiah 46 and verse 8. Remember this, God says, and stand firm. Recall it to mind, you transgressors. Remember the former things of old. For I am God, and there is no other. I am God, and there is none like me. Declaring the end from the beginning, and from ancient times, things not yet done, saying this, my counsel shall stand, and I will accomplish all my purpose. This is God just doing this. I'm God. My counsel will stand. I will. How many know that nations are going to be discipled? Jesus said, this gospel of the kingdom must first be preached in all the nations, all the nations. And then the end's going to come. God, we're praying, Maranatha. God wants this gospel of the kingdom, the power and the witness of this resurrected Jesus in every nation. These guys in Cambodia told me the first time the Protestant gospel came to Cambodia was in 1923 years. Catholics had done some work there before. And I sat there and I grieved in my heart thinking, where was the church for 1900 years? While all of Europe was enjoying revivals and outbreaks, and here are people who are dying and going to hell, and Jesus paid for them. I don't want to say church in Australia like I do all over the world. I'm not picking on you. This is why we're here. Not because we like flying in overextended cigars at 33,000 feet. I don't like flying. But it's an incredible way of getting the gospel to the nations. My purposes shall stand. I want to say that God is in control. God is in charge. He's sovereign. I heard someone say this recently, that God is in charge, but he's not in control. I believe and agree with him. Psalm 115, verse 2. Why should the nation say, where is God? Our God is in heaven. He does whatever he pleases. That kind of sounds a little bit in control for me and in charge. Even when things look out of control. In the book of Acts, it says, chapter 13, it said, those who live in Jerusalem and their rulers, because they did not recognize Jesus, nor understand the utterance of the prophets, which they read every Sabbath, they still fulfilled them by condemning Jesus. This seemingly terrible negative was absolutely a fulfilling of the purposes of God. God is in charge and he is in control. And I come from a nation, Zimbabwe, where I'm born, which looks completely out of control. But I want to say, and I'm there in 3 weeks' time, I'm back in Zimbabwe. And I want to say to them, God is in control and God is in charge. So what about evil? So many people say to me in the world, what about all the evil? I believe a distinction needs to be made. So I want to do this really quickly. I want to get to some of the juicy stuff. But I do want to say this. A distinction has to be made today between God creating evil, like some people try and argue, and God controlling evil. This is where people battle with the thing of how can God be in control when so much evil is happening around us. In terms of creating evil, the Bible says God is not the author or creator of sin, Book of James says. We can't equate evil to God at all. But God can and does often use and control evil. King Cyrus is a great example. God prophesied him by name 150 years before he came into being. Here's some of the things he said about this king of Persia. In the first year of King Cyrus, that the word of the Lord might be fulfilled, the Lord stirred up the spirit of Cyrus. The Lord did it. He says in Isaiah 44:28, he is my shepherd. An idol worshipping evil, unsaved king. He's my shepherd. And he shall fulfill all my purposes. In Isaiah 45:1, the Lord says to his anointed, to Cyrus, whose right hand I have grasped to subdue nations before him. Does God create evil? No. Does he control it? I believe so. For his purposes. Isaiah 45:3, speaking to Cyrus, I will give you the treasure of darkness that you may know that it is I, the Lord, who call you by name. I'm giving you riches, I'm giving you treasures so that you'll know it's me. Isaiah 45:5, I am the Lord, there is no other besides me. I equip you, though you do not know me. Isaiah 45:13, I've stirred him up, Cyrus up, in righteousness, and I will make all his ways level. He will build my city and set my exiles free, says the Lord of hosts. God is in control. Can you say amen? God is in control. That's why we're called to pray to him, even when things seem out of control in our lives. He's also, secondly, the God of breakthrough. He turns negatives into positives. There's not a single funeral Jesus went to that he didn't mess up. Not one. If you wanted a good funeral, don't invite Jesus. He's going to mess up your catering plans. He's going to mess up the casket you bought, because he's the resurrection and he's the life. And we need to see the dead raised. Amen? And we have seen the dead raised. But I'm saying, God, more. Not just ones and twos and threes. God, we want to see the dead raised in Sri Lanka. We want to see the dead raised in Cambodia and in Australia. Nothing is impossible to him. He turns, the negative attracts the positive. The negative of sin attracts the positive of the sinless one. Isaiah 49. The Lord saw the injustice and the lack of righteousness and truth. And the Lord saw that there is no man and wondered why there is no one to intercede. Then his own arm brought salvation. God saw that we were wrestling in our sin, and he stepped in. He turned the negative of sin into a divine positive. The negative of accusation attracts the positive, God's intercession. The devil, the Bible says, is the accuser of you and I day and night. It's relentless. That's pretty negative. But it says that Jesus always lives to make intercession for you and I. He turns those accusations, the negatives, into positives. Let me give you a few examples from Scripture. Number one, he turns an indefensible position where we are cut off from God into unmerited favor. There is nothing that, and religion has been established in the earth to try and bridge the gap between us and God. And that's what most religions are, Gary was saying earlier, about works, how we can somehow appease an angry God. It's an indefensible position. But if we receive unmerited favor from God, a eternal negative, God transforms into a divine positive. Secondly, he turns unintended places, storms in our life, into strategy. There's this great story in Mark chapter 4, verse 35. Jesus says to his disciples, let us go over to the other side. Shemaine and I had the privilege of speaking at a conference. I might have shared some of the stories when I was here last time in Jerusalem and in Jordan. And we got down on one of our off days to the Sea of Galilee, beautiful place. And so we were right here, right where this story is being told. And Jesus said, let's go over to the other side. It's a very clear command. The disciples got into the boat. Most commentators would say Jesus was talking about going to Bethsaida, where four or five of his disciples came from. But it says that a storm blew them off course. Now, I don't know about you, but when you get a command from God, you don't expect storms. I mean, it's really clear. This is where God's sending us, to Sri Lanka. I'm not prophesying a storm, Steve. And the team. But these guys were on assignment by Jesus. We're going to the other side, probably Bethsaida. But a storm, it says, came and blew them off course. And I can imagine the disciples, not you, but the disciples being a little bit grumpy about this. Now, hang on now. Now, we did not sign up for storms. We've given up our businesses. We've become these kind of radical disciples of Jesus. We never sign up for storms. Here we are in a storm, and then they in the country of the Gentiles, the Gadarenes. And I can imagine all of them, but particularly Thomas, having a grumpy day. One, we just about died on this mission trip. And now we end up in the Gentile country. And the first person we meet is this guy, Bill Johnson says, who eats the neighbor's cats. He's naked, in chains. This was not part of the, Jesus, we'll show you the itinerary you gave us. It was supposed to be Bethsaida, kind of a family reunion. Now there's a nice Sunday roast. We end up in a storm, blown off course, and we meet a demon-possessed man with thousands of demons. I'm talking about God. I'm talking about unintended places. God, it's impossible. I'm in this place. You don't know where I live, Lord. You don't know my job. You don't know my situation. You don't know my marriage. Unintended place that I'm in. God specializes in turning negative into divine positives. Amen? And so we see this unintended place becomes a born-again, spirit-impacted moment for this man who was written off by society. And he becomes this effective evangelist, the first in the Gentile nations. How many know God knows what he's doing? Even when there's the odd storm. Now, some storms we need a rebuke. But I want to say, even in the storms, God is in control. And some of these intended places become this strategy of God. I don't know why I'm being through what I've been through, but God, you can take my world, you can take even my mess, and you can transform it into a divine positive this morning. And God might want to do that for you. I don't know why I battle with this kind of bondage or this kind of addiction or this. I don't know why, but God, I know you can transform this. You can take this mess and make it a message. Amen? Unintended places. A number of years ago, there's this very special car that I wanted. And I was absolutely convinced God was all over this car. My wife, not so persuaded. And I wanted this particular car. And we drove into this conference. We had a national conference. And as we drove into the parking lot, there was this car,
pulled in front of me, my car, with a for sale sign on it. Nudged my wife. Signs and wonders. And she was binding the devil. I was rejoicing in Jesus. Anyway, there was not a whole lot of agreement on this thing. But I was persuaded. And when I get persuaded, I'm persuaded. So I found a scripture, I think, from the Book of Mormon, and gave it to her. I went ahead and bought the car. But the guy was in it, so he had to drive back to his, he's in another city. So I went back to our place, very excited, my wife not so. And I had to buy an air ticket to fly to this place. So I bought the ticket. And I went, and the guy said, he's a pastor in the church. He said, please come and minister while you're here, and then you can redo the car transaction. Brilliant. And went over there, preached up a... as I'm getting onto the airplane, it was this really small airport, so I had to walk up a ladder. As my foot hit the first rung of the ladder, I heard the Spirit of God say to me, you will return in the power of the Spirit. So I thought, my wife's wrong, I'm right again. So I changed my messages on their 2-hour flight. I changed my messages, preached this thing about returning in the power of the Spirit, and we had great. God was very gracious. Got in my new car. Halfway back, the car broke down, and I'm just thinking, I'm binding everything I know to bind. I know nothing about engines. End up having to be towed to I was in a real tiny little one. Didn't even have a horse, but so I had to be towed to a place where they had some horses and could fix the car. And I knew someone there, but I didn't have their phone number. So I phoned a friend of mine who I thought would know. I phoned him and said, hey, buddy, bad situation. I'm being in a tow truck going to this town. What is the guy's name? And he said, I'm here in the town. So I said, what are you doing there? He said, I'm here for a conference. So he said, hang on a second. And comes back, he said, my host said you're welcome to come and stay. 3-day conference. My car took 3 days to fix. It was a 3-day conference full of the glory of God. I spent so much time Velcroed to the carpet. Just God doing stuff, putting stuff in and taking stuff out. And I remember getting back once the car was fixed, driving the rest of the way home, full of the Spirit of God. Full of the power of God, what God spoke about. This was an unintended place. This was an unintended situation. It looked so negative, but God turned it into a supernatural positive. I want to say this about that scripture I read in the book of Isaiah, verse chapter 40, whatever it was. Was it 45. Walk through the waters and it will not harm you. You'll go through the fire and it will not harm you. How many want to go through fire? I hope not a single one of you. But that was the scripture I was actually praying for you this weekend. And I felt the Lord say this, without fire, there is no fourth man. Do you remember the 3 Hebrew boys who would not bow in compromise and got thrown into the fire? And it was King Nebuchadnezzar who looked at it and said, that is in Daniel chapter 3. Nebuchadnezzar declared, did we not cause 3 men bound into the fire? They said, yes, so king. He said, but I see 4 men unbound walking in the midst of the fire and they're not hurt. And the appearance of the fourth is like the Son of God. This is an unintended or unlikely deliverance. We're going to die doing this thing. Without the fire, there isn't the fourth man experience, the manifestation of, should I say. We know that God is with us always. But I want to say God turns these unlikely things into positives, divine positives.
It's the same with walking on water. You will walk through the water and it will not harm you. You'll not be overwhelmed. Remember Peter walking on the water? So many people say, God, of course, you're the God of the impossible. And God says, well, get out of the boat, son. No, this is for Gary. This is a word for Gary. We believe you're the impossible, but no, we know this can't happen. We know this is impossible. And I want to say, folks, God is calling us to the supernatural walk. And calling some of you to the supernatural walk. These unusual commands ends up on us walking in water, on water. There's unjust treatments that God is able to turn into supernatural positives. Joseph is a great example. All he's doing is speaking his commands, his dreams. God said this is going to happen, and he's thrown into the pit, and he's thrown into prison. He's rejected by his brothers. I mean, God, what did I do? I'm just saying what you said. This is unjust. God wants him to be prime minister of Egypt. How else is he going to get you there? Stop complaining about how unjust your treatment is and start looking for the God of transformation in your life. Unexpected blessings. The man lying at the pool of Bethesda in John 5. Jesus saw him and said, do you want to be healed? Like, I know you're not a prophet because I've been here for 38 years. Of course I want to be healed, but I can't get into the water in time. He does not realize that God, the healer, God, the creator, is standing before him. An unexpected blessing. The moving waters becomes living waters. And I have so many other stories. I need to finish with this. What is our part? As God begins to turn these supernatural negatives into God's divine positives, four things. Number one, conform to his will. See, I get to meet people all over the world who are facing all kinds of situations. But the Bible says it's not about your will being done. It's about his will being done. And a great question to ask is, if you're in the storm or you're facing some of these unintended storms or persecutions, is am I doing the purposes of God, not my own? Not my parents, not my husband or my wife's. Am I conforming my will to his divine purpose? Number two, am I conforming to his word? It's not yours and not others. The Bible said, God speaking said, I watch over my word to perform it. Jeremiah 1:12. Number three, it's conform to his ways and not our ways. His will, his word, and his ways. The Bible says of his ways that they are not our ways. Honestly, if I had to plan my life, I would have done a really horrible job. Thought I'm smarter than God, many of us do. But our prayer ought to be, God, I'm in your hands. I want to do what you want me to do. What have I been chosen for? Let me lay hold of that for which Christ laid hold of me. And the last thing, and I'm ending with this. Cancel out and neutralize this morning some of the negative things that God has done in people's lives. As God began to kind of unpack this word in my heart, I feel like God, as the God of breakthroughs, the God of transformation, wants to bring
the divine plus into some negative situations here this morning. But make sure we're aligning, first of all, with His ways, His word, and His will. Amen? Won't you please stand with me? Two specific things I feel like God wants to bring is the intimidation of the enemy. Those who are going through storms, those who are going through waters, you're battling. Some of you feel like, Lord, you need to come through. I'm losing ground here. And there's intimidation of the enemy. The Bible says of the devil, he goes around like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. Much of it is done through intimidation. God wants us to operate in faith, not out of fear. And yet I see so often in the church so much intimidation. We've got to quieten down. We cannot be this voice, because the moment I do, I feel like the enemy's come against me. God wants to turn that negative of intimidation into a positive of proclamation. Intimidation, and the other one is accusation. I feel like the enemy has come and accused and accused and accused. And I feel like God wants to break that and bring a divine positive amongst some of the other things I've shared about today. And so if that's you this morning, do you know that song, Oh, the Wonderful Cross? I think it's Michael J. Smith. Oh, the wonderful cross. Do you know it? Wonderful cross, oh, wonderful cross, bids me come and die. We can sing that in a moment or two. Let's sing more songs about the cross. Sing more songs about the blood of Jesus. It's what the devil fears the most. This divine positive, the cross of Jesus Christ. God wants to bring the power of the cross this morning. He wants to bring the power of the blood this morning. And he wants to break off accusation. And he wants to break off particularly intimidation. You're in a storm. We're going to speak. God is still that storm. You feel like I'm maybe not in the place God wants me to be. I'm going to pray that that becomes, that unintended place becomes a strategy of God for you. Maybe it's your marriage. Maybe it's your kids, maybe it's your parents. If you're sitting in a situation or dealing with a situation, is that for anyone here today? You feel like there's this divine, supernatural negative in my life that I'm needing to the front. Maybe you're, if you don't know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, God wants to come and give unmerited grace and favor to you if you don't know Jesus as Lord and Savior. Won't you receive Him today? Like I did, like Gary was sharing earlier. I was so lost. I was dead. Bosses in sin. Jesus came to the power of the cross. And He turned me from a sinner into a saint in a moment, twinkling of an eye. God can do that for you. Maybe it's sickness in your life, this divine negative. I know there was prayer for healing earlier, which is wonderful. God wants to come and cancel out with the work of the devil. He came to destroy it, it says, through the power of the cross. God wants to turn your negative a positive.
the wonderful cross. Oh, the wonderful cross. Bids me come and die and find that I may truly live. Oh, the wonderful cross. All who gather here by grace, draw near and bless your name. Father, we want to worship you this morning for the cross. I know it's a negative in itself, but God, it stands for all time and all eternity as this divine plus on Golgotha. All of heaven and all of hell look and see God's answer to sin. The power of the cross, the power of the blood of Jesus, our King and our Savior. We just lift our voice to Him for a moment, just honor Him. We want to sing, Lord, about this wonderful cross. Oh, the wonderful cross bids me come and die and find that I might truly live. My grace is enough. My grace is sufficient. Your power is perfected in my weakness. God says, is perfected in your weakness. Stop looking at the wave and start looking at me, says the Lord. You've taken your
Some of you need to leave your boats of security and safety. I want you to walk on the water with me, says the Lord. You'll walk through water, you will not be drowned. Would you step out of the boat with me, says God? Would you put your hand in my hand, says the Lord? Stop holding back. Why are you holding back? I want to bring revelation to you, my son and my daughter. I want to bring revelation of nations to you. But I need you to trust me. I need you to say, God, my hand is in your hand. I will not be fearful. And I will not hold back. I will not hold back, says the Lord. And I will cause you to walk through and on the waters. And the Lord says, I promise you, the fires will not harm you. Because I'm in the fire with you. Do not bow your knee and compromise. I feel like there's a glory that God wants to bring in your life, a glory. There's a glory. I feel like God wants to take you to another level. But you've got to get out of your boat. Things have got to change. Feel like the Lord is saying to you, look around. Look around you. Look around your lifestyle. Is this my best for you? Are you living my best? Are you living my dream for your life? God wants to transform the negative to the positive. So that you'll begin to walk in a glory and you'll begin to walk in an anointing that God has for you. And there are dreams that need to be activated, but you need to step out of onto the water. And Father, I want to pray where there's been intimidation. I pray today that there will be this acceleration in the name of Jesus. Intimidation will change to acceleration. I want to thank you, God, for your power and your glory to come. Divine positives. Divine positives. Neutralizing the work of the devil. Neutralize the work of the evil one through the power of the cross. I want to thank you today, Lord, for your power, your glory, and your anointing. In the name of Jesus, I want to speak hope where there is hopelessness. God is turning hopelessness into divine hope. Thank you for a divine exchange. The spirit of heaviness for a garment of praise. Worshipers, worshipers, worshipers. Some of you are complaining. God says, I want that complaining to become intercession. Intercession, take my word. And begin to war with my word. Begin to war with my word. Father, I want to thank you. Divine cancellation. Divine cancellation. In the name of Jesus. Every negative work of the enemy, I cancel it now. In Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Storms become strategies of God. Storms. Be still. Be still. Not off course, I'm on course, says the Lord. You're on course, says the Lord. You're on course. See, the devil has come to rob and steal and kill and destroy, but I've come to give you life. I've come to give you life in greater abundance, in greater quality, greater quality. Spirit of God. Spirit of God. Spirit of God. See, folks, there's a glory God wants to give. It's a glory God wants you to walk in and experience. It's out of this world. It's out of this world. I feel like God wants to transform some people here. you're never going to be the same. You're never going to be the same. You're not going to sound the same. I feel like there's going to be a strategy and a glory that's going to come. But you've got to get out of the boat. Get out of your boat. And it's not being stupid. It's God saying, come. God saying, come. Come. Come to me. Come to me. Would you come to me? Would you come to me? Of course we will. Of course. Of course. Here I come. Here I come, Lord. Here I come. Here I come. Here I come, Lord. Glory is a glory. Is a glory, Lord. I thank you for the power and the glory of God to come. Break and neutralize and destroy the work of the enemy, Lord. In the name of Jesus. 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 I feel like God's opening doors. Folks, on your mind, there's doors. God's saying, open, open, open. Start saying what I say. Start saying what I say. I'm praying prayers of intercession and you're contradicting what I'm saying. Start saying what I say about you. God, God, divine, positive, oh, the wonderful cross, oh, the wonderful cross, oh, the wonderful cross, bids me come and die, find that I might truly live. There's got to be some dying to myself, dying to myself. God, I want to thank you for the power of God right now, right now. Accusation and intimidation, I break that off right now. It's an assignment of the enemy to destroy. And God is canceling. God is canceling that assignment. God is canceling that assignment against you. And I cancel it in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, I cancel that in Jesus' name right now. The work of the evil one will not have his way. This is God's property. You will not trespass on God's property. And I thank you for divine power and divine favor and divine glory to come, Lord. A glory, a glory. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Father, I want to pray for this church. I want to pray a glory on this church, Lord. A measure on this church. And the enemy has come. There's a glory, God says. There is a glory. I thank you, Father. I thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Gary, can I pray for you? Praying for Gary because he's the gatekeeper in this church. I feel like God wants to bring something through these gates. Father, where the enemy is wanted to come and rob and steal and destroy, Jesus, you always come to bring life. Life. And I want to pray a life of God in this place. I want to pray a life of God in this place as they've not seen another measure, higher heights and deeper depths, higher heights and deeper depths of a glory and an anointing in this place. Father, I'm asking for an explosion of dreams and visions in this place, almost a commissioning of people. That people have been hiding in the shadows and God is calling you out today. I feel like He's calling this church to be a people who literally do step out of boats and begin to walk in the supernatural, in the unnatural. The unnatural in a supernatural way. God is calling this church to walk over waters and even to walk into places that are unusual. Father, I want to thank you for an anointing and a glory this morning upon Gary and Sarah and the leadership team. Through them, unusual places and unusual faces. That there are doors that are opening. God is wanting to take you into unusual places. You'll see unusual faces. Father, I want to thank you for a glory. I want to thank you for pioneering. I thank you for bringing people in here, Father, who will underwrite, but also who will walk with and travel with and go and plant and seed and pray. And stand in the gap on behalf of nations and suburbs. Father, you have such a heart for this nation of Australia. And you're wanting a people, you're wanting a covenant people who bear your image. Image bearers. So, Father, I want to thank you today for this gifted man and this gifted couple. I feel like, Gary, God's saying that God's going to take you into a very, very spacious place. I know you do travel lots, but I feel like even in that you felt like at times your wings have been clipped. I feel like God's saying, I'm taking you into a spacious place. Because God has called you to soar and God has called you to roar. So, Father, I want to thank you for those spacious places. Spacious. Spacious. There's going to be a freedom, Gary. There's going to be a freedom for you and for your family and for your family, the church. A freedom. Freedom. We sang it this morning. A freedom. So, Father, I want to thank you for that. Thank you for that glory, God. A glory. God's going to do something unusual. I'm not sure what it is. I feel like God's there's a something, another glory. Another glory. Of course, it's all about Him. It's not about you. It's not about this church. But there's another glory. It's another measure of the glory that God wants to take you into. He is the God of the impossible. God of transformation. Of the wonderful cross. Of the wonderful cross. Bids me come and die. Find that I may truly live. By grace draw near. Wonderful cross. This is your positive, Lord. This is your divine positive. Transforming negatives. Transforming negative. Watch for God's deliverance. Watch for God's deliverance. Watch the negative turn into a positive. Watch. Come and be God, Lord. God in control, God in charge. We worship you, Lord.
Gary, I have to speak this because I really just feel it's for you. I just kept getting the word that you stayed at this mountain long enough. It's time to break camp and move. And you're not to fear, Gary. There's almost like a fear thing. If I move, what's going to happen? And I just feel, I've been just getting that word, God saying, do not fear, Gary, but it's time. You've been there long enough. And I don't know if it resonates with you, but I just feel God said it's time to break camp. It's time to move.
Thank you, God. Jesus Christ, we love you with all of our hearts. We're so proud of you. We're so proud of you. We're so proud to belong to you. We're so proud to carry your image in us. Australia is desperate to see the image of Jesus in and on the church. So desperate. They've seen such counterfeits. They want to see the image of Jesus. They want to see the image of Christ. God, help us. Would you come and help us, Lord? Your church in Australia, Lord. Such a purity, such a holiness, and such a glory. From glory to glory. He's changing us from one degree of glory to another. I thank you, Father. You're so beautiful. Your presence is amazing. We have the fourth man, even in the fire. Looks like the Son of God. Unbound. Unbound. In the fire. Unbound in the fire. Just worship you, Lord. Like someone's in a marriage that has really been so tough, and you can't see a single good thing in your situation, in the storm that you're in. I feel like God wants you to look at Him. Stop looking at the situation. You've just been staring at the storm for too long. Watch for God's strategy. Watch for His presence. Fix your eyes on Jesus, the Bible says. Fix your eyes on Jesus. Don't ever take your eyes off Him. Stop looking at your husband, your wife. And you'll begin to see the glory of God way beyond what you've ever imagined. There's a glory in your life. There's a glory on your life. That God wants to bring is the deliverance that God wants to bring to you. Standing somewhere in the shadows, you'll find Jesus. He's the only one who cares and understands. Standing somewhere in the shadows, you'll find Him. You'll know Him by the nail prints in His hands. He's never left you. Never. Thank you, Jesus.
Amen. Thank you, Father. Wow.
we just show our love to Mike and Charmaine. Thank you, Father. Incredible word. Incredible word. Please, if you're still receiving, please just stay there. Father, we thank you for today. Lord, we thank you. Lord, we thank you for the call upon Mike and Charmaine's life. Father, we thank you of the assignments that are on their life. And Lord, I pray that you would continue to open up, continue to illuminate, and continue to cause increase to happen in their lives, in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Have a great Sunday, and we look forward to seeing you soon. Bless you.